Hey folks, it's Glenn with the almost world famous Cactus Atlas, and join us today as we tell you a little bit about a kind of darker Arizona history, about the death of a very famous movie star right here in this general vicinity. And then we're going to go seek out an era ranch that would have existed right around the time of the tragedy. The beginning of our adventure today starts at the Tom Mix Memorial, which represents the site of his death. This is the modern Route 79 between Florence, Arizona and Tucson, and you can see Mount Lemmon out there with snow on its peaks. And this is a very loud, busy road, actually. A lot more well-traveled than I thought it would be. It's rare to get a second without the noise of vehicles driving by, which is kind of ironic because of what happened here at this location. And you can see here the date of his death, October 12th of 1940. And Tom Mix died, according to this, on this spot. However, I don't think it was literally on this spot as the sign portrays, but in a wash a couple hundred yards down the way that we're gonna go try to seek out. Today, this is just a little memorial. I think I've driven by it before. And a lot of people seem to just be pulling over. You know, guys mostly, younger looking, maybe in their 20s, 30s. I've seen a couple, and they just run back here to the desert to tinkle. I might have done that myself, but probably never the wiser as to what happened here on this very spot, or so much as to who was Tom Mix. Not really a name, you know, in our modern times. As embarrassed as I kind of am to say it, my knowledge of Tom Mix was that line at the end of the movie Tombstone with Kurt Russell, Val Kilmer, the classic my generation has grown up and loved, where the very last line is like they're talking about Wyatt Earp's funeral, and it's like, and Tom Mix wept. I'm like, oh, Tom Mix, some old timer, I guess. That's about as far as my knowledge went for many years. So I don't have to recite a bunch of facts about Tom Mix here. I'm a busy guy too. I am going to enlist Slim here to be our little historian of the day. He's gonna have a bit part in today's episode, but Slim, why don't you tell them a little bit about Tom Mix while we make our way down to see if we can locate the actual site of the tragedy.
Known as the King of Cowboys, Tom Mix was one of the earliest actors to portray the archetype of the Western cowboy. Starring in 291 films, many of which are now lost, Mix was one of the biggest stars in the silent film age, from his first role in 1909 to his last in 1935. Forming a love for horses at an early age, Mix was a natural at roping, ranching, and riding, making his introduction into film an obvious win for studios. Performing his own stunts, Mix earned a hefty salary, the equivalent of about $100,000 a week. With this kind of cash, Mix was able to purchase a ranch in Prescott, Arizona, a circus in which he traveled and performed with, and a 1937 Cord 812 Phaeton. As a friend of Wyatt Earp and pallbearer at his funeral, Mix was admired by many. But with the transition to talkies, as well as having suffered numerous facial and neck injuries from years of performing stunts, Mix quit acting and returned to circus performing. He did, however, keep that car.
I think just like, it's probably hard today to understand how huge he was, but he was likely the childhood hero of people like Ronald Reagan and John Wayne and guys like that, I would imagine. But there's a sandy wash here. Could this be the Tom Mix wash? This very well might be it. It's about the distance I thought it would be. And we think we've seen that there might be memorials out here. This might give us a good perspective of the incident. Now, I'm not saying this, I couldn't tell you if this is the bridge that was being constructed, the thing that led to Mr. Mix's end, or a more modern version, you know, probably something more modern, but regardless, you can kind of see the terrain and what was likely going on that horrible day. So on that October day, Mr. Mix would have been speeding down here. Based on the account, I'm assuming a little buzzed. Probably he had been drinking, I think is what I read, in Oracle Junction or something not far from here, making his way. Hey, it was the 1940s or the end of the 30s, 1940 specifically. So I guess it's a different time, kids. But he didn't, you know, the workers saw him coming from down the road would have seen dust of a car that wasn't slowing down, and when he saw like the signs to beware, he would have, I guess, gone off course and swerved off trying to stop, and his yellow cord flew into this very ditch that we stand in. And over here there's some crosses that Amy located. There's two very worn wooden crosses here. I'm gonna be very careful where we step. So you would have to think, you know, we're right out by the memorial that said he died on, the memorial says on the spot, but the way we read it, his car was here, flipped upside down. One thing I didn't know, according to this article they had pasted to the table, is that the first person that came upon him saw movement in the vehicle, and I always heard that a suitcase broke his neck, that a suitcase flew into his neck, I thought during the impact of the crash, but it sounds like a trunk fell like on his neck while he was squirming around and instantly broke his neck or something to that nature. But, and there was a legend that it was full of silver dollars is one thing I read. Here's where things get interesting. So I don't know. That's where I don't know what's fact and what's not. But, you know, the more I read about him, how big of a personality he was and how well known he was, and to be here now, it's just one of those things that, yeah, new respect. I also read something about a rock. I want to be really careful while I'm stepping. This is a lot of rot holes on the ground here, but there was a rock, I think, where his name was Mick, like written on it, Mix. But there's a rock right there next to the memorial, and then there's a lot of overgrown brush here. I don't see any writing on it, anything discernible from this angle, but you never know. But I wish I knew how to date that. It looks old and weathered and rotted, and there's two markers, and I'm not here to dishonor anyone's memory or whatever, but I wonder how much alcohol may have played in that. You know, we don't really know. I mean, this was 1940, and I don't think drunk driving was yet a thing, seat belts, things like that. So, and I just can't imagine him driving, they said 80 miles an hour in most accounts I've read. One even said 100 miles an hour. That car was supercharged, I think capable of 100, but yeah, somebody in a just hunk of metal, heavy piece of metal, convertible, no seatbelt on, and whew, crash. All right, a piece of Arizona history I never really understood the full magnitude of what happened here until now, and it's somber. Okay, so now the next thing we decided to do is there's an old ranch not far from here. And in fact, if we turn back on 79 and go make a left and go north again back towards Florence, maybe a mile, 2 miles up the road, there's a right turn onto something called, I think, 96 Ranch Road. I believe that's our beginning point for the journey out to the ranch. And the thing that's interesting about it is it's a popular spot for off-roaders just because there's buildings there left over from an older time, not quite as old as we usually like, but still old. But interestingly, from almost the exact time frame of when this happened, if the information I found is correct. Now I know, kind of a loose tie-in, I know, but that's the best I got. There isn't much out here. Well, there's some stuff out here we've already seen, but you can see around here. This is kind of the middle of nowhere. And we made it, and this is what I was looking for. This is that a Santa Fe style, is that the right term for that, like a Pueblo looking thing? That I believe is from the 1930s, And we're gonna look inside and see if we can find touches that corroborate that time, but I don't see why it wouldn't be. This is the site though of an old ranch, presumably started in the 1930s, the 96 Ranch. I think the hills behind me are called the 96 Hills. I don't know if they were named after the ranch or vice versa, but on this property, there should be some old structures, and that I think is La Pièce de Résistance. But first, before we do that, let's talk about the ride in here, because I wasn't really doing a full off-roading video today, but if you want to come visit it, a couple things to state. I would say if you're going to be down in Florence visiting the Tom Mix Memorial and you want to see some cool history that's a little hidden and harder to get to, this might be your prime thing. I would say this road, I would say anything can do 1 out of 10 all day, at least up to this point. I know the roads continue and they wind back here, but if you're making a beeline for this thing, don't worry about it. Let me show you what Amy and I got going on too while I'm out here. We added something new to the Cactus Atlas, a simple fix to get over one of my biggest gripes, and I'll show you here on top of the truck. You can see I have a GoPro on a magnet mount on top of my truck, and what we were testing is how well will it stay in place, because there's a ball, kind of a cheaper feeling ball joint. This thing got good reviews. Not ready to review it myself, but so far it's flawless. And those magnets are on there like you wouldn't believe. There's a secret to getting them off, but there is a tether that I just opted not to use because I did some preliminary testing yesterday and I don't see how that could possibly go anywhere. It's a challenge getting it off, but I want your guys' feedback though in the comments about this footage versus what you've seen up to date. Only other things that I'll mention that I wasn't expecting were just how beautiful the surrounding terrain and Sonoran Desert is here. A lot of like those eroded, round, I assume granite boulders and tons of saguaro. Oh wow, this is very extensive down here. I assume part of the ranch operation, there's, what does that there say? It's a K? The 96 is what this is called, but I don't know if that's the brand, like in the gate there. It doesn't look like a 9 and a 6, it looks like a K. And like a, almost like a key or something like that. But this is a beautiful little area down here. It's just like tucked away, lush. There's a water source. I think that runs like right along the bottom of here. So I think this, when I was reading the real estate listing, it was really trying to sell the various ways you can ranch land and use it. That seemed to be the selling point, the types of grasses and things that grow here and the resources that one could use more so than the property. It just mentioned there were some abandoned structures on there. So if you were a modern rancher, I'm assuming this is a viable piece of land to conduct your trade. Yes? So this is the old 96. I thought it was gonna look a little very modern, but in person it does not. It does have that age and look to it. The wood especially, like in the windowsills, and I don't know the term for those wooden pieces that poke out like you would see in like adobe structures, but anyway. This is sometime circa 1936 as far as we can tell. All right, let's cross the barrier here into the old 96 ranch. And then I'll tell you a couple tidbits of info. And like I said, there's not too much that really I think needs to be, that can be said about it, at least not today with what I got off the internet. Now I've noticed on the front facade as well as here, this interesting thing that almost looks like, was there a plaque or something installed in that? Or was that something more, some kind of water utility, something like that? I don't really know. But you can also see like the old wood sticking out in the windowsills, and this thing, as far as we know, isn't quite 100 years old. But imagine like another 100 years from now, another 200 years from now, is this gonna be another thing lost to time and just crumbling and there's just bits and pieces of it left? Or will the modern building materials prevail? All right, I haven't fully gone in there yet. I poked my head in very quickly and I'm very excited to look at and try to discern more. Lots of like an old fuse box and some signs of electricity on here, which isn't surprising. We'll look at the prongs and the outlets and see if we can date them to prior to like 1960s. I have an idea, but before we get to that, I saw pictures of this interesting stairway here and I didn't know where it was, but I found it. This concrete stairway that leads down to, I don't know what, ooh, a cellar. There's a cellar here. I actually feel a very cool breeze. I'm gonna need light, because I can't see if there's any snakes. But this is an old cellar and it smells, you know the smell of like standing next to a railroad with the railroad ties? I'm gonna come in, I think it's, my eyes are adjusting more. It smells like that. Probably because there's giant railroad ties on the ceiling in here. Oh, wow. So this, I would have to assume, was a place to keep items cool, probably jarred goods, I'm gonna guess. Maybe like their version of a fridge. A cellar, I mean, it's built into the hill here. I don't even want to bring a UV light in here and see what's probably, it's dark enough that I can't see things that I don't like, because this seems like a haven for bad things. You can kind of see here the walls eroding. I didn't think to bring my headlamp today. I don't know what kind of material that is, but it's like a plaster. And then there's stuff like deteriorating underneath, probably water damage is what it is. But the smell, I love that smell. It's just when you smell that old wood smell like that, railroad ties, it just makes me want to say yeehaw for some reason. Now this material is kind of like, you know, a plaster. It's not that hard though. It almost feels hollow. You could see there's this honeycomb material. It's metal and then there's wood. So wooden building with this wire stuff, then plaster on top. It seemed to be the building technique, and then the wooden frames and all of that cool stuff. I don't want to leave here. It's so nice and comfortable. I'll tell Amy about it though. I think she'll like that. Wow, yeah, you can really feel the difference in temperature. Big time, even more now you feel the heat than before. All right, let's maybe venture inside the main event, or what I'm gonna dub the main event. Swing around the back maybe and see if we can enter from the other side. I don't know what this building's best side is. Kinda like to search for the dead bodies first before I go in. Very neat, but it seems like a nice place to me. It seems like it would have been a nice place. Even now, all of these years later, you can really envision, I think. And I'm guessing it even had a patio. Probably would sit out there and eat. And this may have been their yard. And you could see people artificially planted saguaro all in a line, as is not uncommon at old ranches out here, as we're finding. And I'm guessing things like this, these plants are not native to this area, so this palm is probably an addition of someone who lived here, as well as that large, I don't know what that is. It's a piney thing. I don't know if it's a type of juniper, cedar, or exactly what that is, but it doesn't look like it's naturally here in the middle of the Sonoran Desert. So another thing presumably planted by the former owners of this. All right, we'll go in there and maybe we'll hear echoes from the past and a dinner conversation about what happened with Tom Mix. And hopefully I don't get killed by stinging insects as I come in here, but it actually seems a lot cleaner. My first remark is there are some wasps in here, but they don't seem to bother too much. They're just kind of exploring. The ceiling is so low is my first, what I gotta say. I'm 6'2", so I'm kind of on the taller side, I know. But I mean, the ceiling is like, if I stood on my tiptoes, I probably have like not that much left to go. So walking in here directly, I think the first thing that I see would be where a kitchen used to be, and there's an old electric outlet. We'll study some of those up close, because I'll tell you about my idea in a minute. But basically you could see where what I assume was the hot and cold water. I guess there's probably a sink right here, right next to this nice window with a view. Looking straight out there, imagine doing your dishes right here. Wouldn't that be nice? I believe it was in the 1960s where there was a mandatory switch to those three-prong outlets that we have today to properly ground, which prior to that, I think grounding in homes was either non-existent or whatever. So by 1960, If you see one with three prongs, you would think that the electricity was updated 1960 on, and guess what? I see three prong outlets. So my guess is someone was living here well beyond the 1930s, probably, you know, 1960s on. I wouldn't be surprised, 70s, 80s, who knows? So some more modern touches. Would you guys agree or disagree with what I'm saying? Please comment either way though, always curious about that. Now you've got the wooden ceiling here, and this thing's old and falling apart. And yeah, you got all this cabinetry built into the wall, which is a nice touch. I see a lot of that in these older homes, as you know, from those time frames, interestingly. People, I think, had a little bit more taste back then. It's a nice, breezy spring day here, and the breeze blowing through these windows is so fantastic right now, being in the shade. And I have to wonder, you know, the people living back here, if this does date back to the 30s, which I can buy it being here. I would say they wouldn't have had air conditioning. So having a nice day like today, these are the days you live for in Arizona, and just the hell it must have been in the summertime without air conditioning. Okay, I need to bend down a lot in this place. You can see the wasps live in the walls. There's lots of holes and they're just going in and out. And here's the fireplace I read about online. People said that there's a really nice ornate fireplace in here, and I would agree, that's a beauty. It's an absolute beauty. One of the nicest abandoned fireplaces I've seen. And over here you've got your bookshelf. There's like an electrical box hooked up to it. But yeah, you see those touches from back then. A lot of built-in cabinetry and things of that nature, which really are those touches that I love. And just, there's a more ornate nature. These nice windowsills here. And the patio. Remember I surmised they had a patio. Maybe this wasn't so much the patio, but the front door, I bet. Maybe that was their entryway. There's a sidewalk going out to a gate. So I bet you this could very well be one of the front facades of the house. What a fantastic find this is. So in this very room, you have to wonder, after the sad news of Tom Mix happened, did people hang out in here and discuss it in this very room at the time? It's so possible, it's almost a certainty. Ah, there's a technique from a different time. I don't know if that would live up to standards today in our modern neighborhoods, but you got one of these wasps there. They just check you out every once in a while. It's adobe brick, you see that? So maybe that's a clue as to age. Maybe it is older than you think, and maybe it was built over, like over time, but another clue for somebody else to help us decipher. I really couldn't tell you what the significance of that building technique is in terms of dating. Isn't there like a major in college devoted to this whole science of preserving old buildings and probably being knowledgeable about this stuff? There's probably a light fixture right there. More wasps everywhere, but I'm proof that they don't mess with you unless you mess with them. Is that an old fire detector or doorbell, would you guys guess? I don't know, there's another, you could see there were outlets here. You can see holes in the plaster revealing the underlying, almost looks like ship tack under there. And who knows, maybe at a time it was and they plastered over it. That's the, how these places evolved oftentimes. You can still see the original in the closets where they would have hung their clothes. And I thought I saw one other cool thing here. I'm gonna show you. Look carefully at the ground. And there's very ornate tile, it looks like. Or, I don't know, I hate to call it ornate, but this room, I believe, would have been tiled in this reddish color, and the tile's still on the floor in pieces. It's very thin tile. I'll show you how thin that is. I don't know what that kind of thing was, but, so this room would have had that, like, reddish maroon tile. And then there was, like, a lot of the sidewalk on the side of the house had that brickwork also to match. They had baseboards, it looks like. I mean, for being out here in the boonies, I mean, this would have been a nice place, I reckon. So I guess, if I had to guess, this was someone's bedroom. Probably a master bedroom. This is a really big room here. I saw a, there's an adjoining room here. I did see a bathroom with a bathtub, so we'll hit that on the way out. But you could see a lot of this room is kind of disintegrated. The roof here has suffered probably the worst. You see a lot of the, what is rotted away here, and yeah, I don't know. More of the floor. There's more tile, a different style of tile in here, a clear color that goes back this way, and a big closet, it looks like, or some kind of storage room, maybe a pantry? I don't know. And then looking out the front window. We'll walk around this way, the room over here. It's like I'm a real estate agent giving you a tour of the home here. that's the main room, and then we're gonna walk in here where we really see some bad damage. It's a fixer-upper, guys, it's a fixer-upper. But here's the bathroom that I saw when I walked in. Old tub, you could see, I guess stainless steel appliances there, or faucets, because those are not rusted at all. And I don't know, like that looks like a, there's metal under there with like a, I don't know, ceramic or, no, that's solid. That's like, that is like a, not cheap. That is solid ceramic and, boy, so probably a hint. You could see the glue, I guess they would have had tile or something, backsplash. There was a shower head there. So I bet not as old as you would think, and there's the toilet. So running water at some point. And then more medicine cabinet, and then more three-prong outlets and light fixtures. So I'll kind of let Amy have her time in here and give her her assurance that's safe to go in and not to worry about the wasps, but fantastic little find. One of the coolest abandoned homes that I have come out to film in Arizona. Even though it's not as old as I like the 1800s and the Old West, but there's so little of that left that these are the next treasures for our generations. I'm now standing directly on top of the cellar in which Amy is inside right now, and getting you a good overview of this area with that old corral, the old windmill, those old tanks, they're all rusted now, betraying their age. And clearly this place has not been used for quite some time. All right, so beyond the ranch house here, there's this area. Like I said, that's an interesting thing. I didn't read anything about the gate, but I'm guessing that's the brand of the ranch at one point, and where the cattle would have been worked down there. And then what we'll do is, there's an old concrete building that Amy saw. She has no idea what it was. I don't think there are any windows or anything, so I don't know. We'll find out. And then this curious little place here, which is probably, I guess, where they would load cattle up or something on the road. Little shaded pavilion for people, I don't know. Looks like we can actually sneak around easily and check this out from this side, kind of down a ways from the house we'll go. And it's worth a look. Wow, that's just such a cool sight. Maybe not as interesting as like a mining type of an operation to me, and I do like a little bit older, but still, it's like, to me, whenever you're approaching 100 years old, which is really what my best guess is here, it starts to get to that point in time where there aren't many people left to tell the tales. And that's why it's fascinating to come, I guess, wonder about all the little human things that happened around here at one time. After having that rattlesnake encounter on the road, I'm kind of hesitant in walking back in this tall grass right now. And, you know, this thing I'm guessing is some kind of large cistern for collecting water. That would be my best guess. When I get the drone up before we leave, we'll survey this whole thing and get it from the air. But if I had to guess, that's probably what we were looking at. Thank you. think this is the end of the private property line. It's a small parcel compared to the surrounding land, but you know, gates wide open, very welcoming, no sign saying don't come in, and it connects public land, so I'm guessing that's why the private landowner is okay with people coming through. Just don't make it a mess, that's all people want. And here is that building Amy found. Looks like there was a pipe that got water at some point, and then basically covered in little pockmarks of bullets. The most common, I'm gonna call it Arizona graffiti, in my opinion, are just people that shoot old structures. You know, I'm gonna start taking this trash with me coming out here, but this right here, shotgun shell, this type of thing, the number one piece of plastic trash that I find in our Arizona National Forest, by far, followed by beer cans. All right, this is the only other structure. I think there were more at some point. You could see some have fallen. Seen some old pictures, but this appears to be the end of the property line, and older thing with concrete walls, and see if we can find an entrance in it. I saw like pipes going in, presumably for water. This side is sealed shut. There's a little opening there. We'll go around the other side. Amy told me about a building that she couldn't figure out what it was. And I'm like, surely there's gotta be a door. Nothing, it's sealed shut from all sides. So what the heck could that have been? There would have been like an opening there, I guess. And the only other clue is I see a water pipe going up. So is this to protect a pump? Was it a pump station or something like that? Is my best guess, but it's really strange how all four sides, there's no doors, no windows, except for entry through the roof, I guess. Just like the natives used to do. There are some foundations also left over from some other building at some point in time, probably maybe more of a workshop area or something for the ranch, I would guess. Or maybe it was another house, as far as we know. Who knows? And then that strange, mysterious building with no windows or doors. There are no windows and no doors. And there's more stuff down here. It's all overgrown though. There's a retaining wall of some sort, and it looks like they probably filled in maybe this, and there was a structure here at some point, and maybe what looks like an old grill or barbecue. We'll find out. Very square foundation. Of course, the main house, if I didn't point it out, the floor was concrete. There was a foundation there. But I see this over here, and that looks like an old like barbecue or something to me. The Tom Mix Memorial site had something very similar in look and feel to this. So either that, or I was gonna say a fireplace, but it doesn't, you know, seem to be built in a place where the house was. There's another retaining wall and probably water drainage down there. So my guess is some kind of an outdoor cooking pit, which makes me wonder, was this residential in nature here? And looking down into that overgrown bush, I see more fences that I probably couldn't see from down there, but fantastic little place. Well, folks, there you have it. What Amy and I have heard referred to as the old 96 ranch, an old abandoned ranch. We think it's a contemporary of Mr. Tom Mix in the time that he tragically died right out a few miles down the road. And it's really neat to explore another piece of Arizona history, even though it doesn't give up all of its secrets. There's a charm to it. See you next time, and thanks for joining us. Bye.